The Lawrence Western estate was the only constant in my life. We go back there after every summer season, and it was the place where I did a lot of my growing up. The estate backed onto a wide, barren piece of scrubland, interspersed with parking facilities for lorries. But mostly, it was wasteland, awaiting developers' careless drawings. Sandwiched between this vast space and the sky was a huge chemical works. Behind that was the point where the M4 motorway, which went from east to west, met the M5, which went north to south. Life on the Lawrence Western estate was always on the chaotic side of shambolic. Despite the fact that Dad was getting more work as an entertainer, he only earned a pittance, and we still existed from hand to mouth. We led an almost feral life, dressed in other people's cast-offs and living off whatever food we could muster. The funny thing was, although there was crime on the estate, I never felt threatened or uneasy. There was the odd scare, but it was always taken care of by the older boys, who were very protective towards the younger ones. It was a close neighbourhood. If there was a break-in, Dad would tell us, poking his fork at us for emphasis while he ate dinner. "If anyone got in here, I'd kick the shit out of them." He was scary when he said it, but it made me feel a lot safer, knowing he would confront them, and not me. Most of the residents would know who'd done it anyway, through the various channels of gossip. Everyone knew everyone else's business, without ever involving the police. It was always taken care of. An example of how protective the older boys were was, one evening, when my mate Jeff and I were playing a game of football after school, the local flasher came out of nowhere and pulled his pants down in front of us. Jeff shouted across the main road to his house, and his two older brothers were out as quick as a flash, so to speak, chasing after him across the back fields, shouting at the top of their voices, "Come here, you dirty bastard!" Suddenly, from nowhere, there was a gang swarming the estate looking for him. Lucky for that flasher, they never caught him. If they had, he would definitely have had a cauliflower beanbag, as Jeff's brothers, Keith and Pete, were rock hard. They returned saying, "If he comes back, get a call, and we'll kick him right in the rucksack. He won't flash any more. He won't even have a dim light." One day, when we were 13 and 11, my brother Wayne and I were in the middle of the backfields. The only thing you could hear was the occasional cricket. We were weaving our way blissfully through the long, wet grass, when suddenly Wayne ducked down, covering his head with his hands. He turned and looked up at me, shouting, "What's that?" I thought it was another one of Wayne's wind-ups. I just carried on with my stroll. "You do my head in, you do, Wayne." But then, suddenly, something whizzed past my head really fast. I turned towards Wayne, but he wasn't there. "Wayne? Where'd he gone?" A voice came from deep within the tall grass. "Lee, get down!" Again, something else whipped past my head, closer this time, and cracked into the grass. I folded to my knees, curling into a ball. I waited there for a moment. Not lifting my head that stay firmly tucked between my legs, I shouted, "Wayne, what was that noise? What you up to? It's not me, you tosser. That's an air gun, that is. Someone's firing at us." I instantly began to sob. I was frightened. "I want to go home." I heard Wayne moving, and I lifted my head and saw him on his knees peeking over the top of the grass, trying to get a better look. There was a sudden low thud as another pellet hit the wet mud next to him. Wayne ducked back into the grass and looked over at me. "There's a bloke over by the flats. I reckon it's him." I buried my head into the flattened grass and began crying into the soil below, confused. "What have we done? I haven't done nothing, Wayne." I was snapped out of it by a muffled bollocks to this. I looked up and saw the soles of Wayne's dap shoot past me. He was making a run for it. I was on my own. I panicked, jumped to my feet and ripped after him. We ran across the field to the sound of pellets whizzing past our heads and cracking into the grass around us. Why does anyone fire a loaded gun at two small boys in the middle of a field? The only reason can be that this deficient twat has too much time on his hands. He has saved up his money from the labour exchange and bought a gun. Anyone who has held a gun will know that as soon as you pick it up and hold it in your hands, there is some kind of weird, overwhelming urge to fire it. It's something to do with an ancestral hunting throwback in our genes. Well, Chartneston over there was certainly a throwback. It must have been quite a buzz that filled his meagre, uneventful day as he aimed at two live humans. Of course, when we started running for our lives, that must have made it all the more of a thrilling prospect for him. Moving targets. To him, we were just two little dots on the landscape that jumped, bobbed and weaved their way around the inside of his telescopic sight. We managed to make it to the sanctuary of the back sheds near the flats, slamming our backs against the wall. Hearts pumping faster than pistons. We were safe. Rumours on the estate soon alerted us to the identity of the shooter. He most certainly wouldn't have expected two dots on the landscape, mere unconnected ducks at a shooting gallery, to arrive at his front door in the company of a rather larger, rather angrier dot. Dad. Nor would he have expected that loud thumping knock on his front door as he was just about to sit down with his wife for tea. Muffled from behind the closed door, we heard him muttering, "Who the hell is it that keeps knocking on our door?" I saw the outline of the airgun man appear behind the thick frosted glass. Watching the figure fumble around for the latch, I felt sick as a wave of fear swept over my body. I hadn't seen him up close. He might be big and hurt my dad. The door opened slightly and the man peered out from the gap. I could only see one eye and a nose. I wanted to run. I didn't know when, but I knew an explosion was about to happen.
All right then. What are you banging on my door for?
You got a fucking air gun, mate, Dad snapped at him. Before the bloke could even answer the question, Dad let go of our hands and pushed his way in through the door. Grabbing the front of the man's shirt, he held him in the air just inside the hall, then repeated the question very slowly and deliberately. Tell me, have you got a fucking air gun? Dad must have spotted the gun because we heard him shouting, "This yours, mate!" The man just let out a sort of scared whimpering sound. Dad knocked the door shut. Now it was closed, it was a little easier for us. All we could hear were muffled shouts from Dad and the odd little squeaks, moans and cries of fear from the airgun man. Through the frosted glass, we could only watch the two performing outlines of Dad and the man frantically bobbing and weaving like a particularly noisy mime act. With one hand, Dad was holding the poor man aloft by the throat, and with the other, he was brandishing the gun. Dad shook it in the air. "See this? I'm going to stick this right up your ass!" I stared, frozen and dumbfounded. Wayne and I were fascinated. The two figures in the flat were jostling each other, their arms suddenly shooting out at different directions and their bodies confusingly merging into one, then suddenly splitting apart. Then, out of nowhere, another character arrived, accompanied by a high-pitched screaming. We saw the outline of the airgun man's wife, arms flailing, head shaking, hair flopping this way and that. She tried to quell Dad's rage, but now it was getting difficult to tell exactly what was going on. But it looked like Dad was behind the man with the woman on Dad's back. Then the airgun man began to let out a series of odd, guttural animal sounds. In the confusion, someone must have reached for the latch because the door slowly swung open, revealing the appalling scene. Poor airgun man's eyes stared at us, desperate for help, as we watched Dad quite literally trying to stick the end of the gun through the back of the man's trousers and, as he promised, up his arse. Never has Dad's hair-trigger temper been more evident. But at least airgun man was unlikely to take potshots at kids again.